Every journey has to start somewhere. My journey to the Antarctica Marathon started with a 29-hour flight from Seattle to Buenos Aires, Argentina. Here, I met up with other runners who had chosen to participate in the Antarctica Marathon and Half Marathon, the first events of their kind to be conducted on the seventh continent. After a day of sightseeing and getting to know one another, we headed south to the city of Ushuaia, Argentina, at the bottom of South America. Ushuaia, formerly the home of an Argentine penal colony, now hosts more willing visitors seeking adventure in the Patagonian wilderness and beyond. From Ushuaia, we would sail south across the Drake Passage to Antarctica. We had been divided into two groups of 80. After we arrived in Ushuaia, we watched the first group sail away from the pier and into the Beagle Channel. We would not see them again until race day. The next day, it was our turn. Late on Wednesday afternoon, we boarded the Academic Yafe, a former Russian research ship still crewed by Russian sailors and officers. This would be our home for the next 8 days. Before sailing, Tomas Holik, the expedition leader, warned us about the dreaded Drake Passage.
After 5 hours, we dropped the pilot, and in half an hour later, we are heading into the Drake Passage. Now, the Drake Passage is not the Beagle Channel. It begins to move from that place. If it's windy here, probably it will be windy outside, with the difference that the waves, instead of being of only this size, they will be of 17 meters, 20 meters. But we hope that less. Yeah, more or less 50 feet. So that's big.
Yeah, no kidding.
We came today in the morning. We crossed the Drake Passage in 2 days, coming from Antarctica, and it was fairly calm. We hope that it will be fairly calm on the way in. But you never know.
Fear of the Drake Passage vanished as the lines were cast off and the ship steamed away from the dock. We waved an adios to Argentina. Ushuaia quickly fell away behind us. A hard wind was blowing from the east as we headed down the Beagle Channel to the Southern Ocean. Argentina was on the port side and Chile was off to starboard. The water was rough in the narrow channel.
The hues to the land where fancy is free. Stand where the peaks meet the sky and the rocks reach the sea. Where the rivers run clean and the bracken is golden in the sun. And cares of tomorrow must wait till this day is done.
It's 620 nautical miles from Ushuaia to Antarctica. At a speed of 13 knots per hour, we were in for a long trip. Morning found us in the Drake Passage. Moderate to heavy swells were making it rough for some of the new sailors. To pass the time, those who weren't seasick took a guided tour of the ship. After the tour, some adjourned to the well-appointed ship's lounge, while others tended to more mundane tasks in their cabins. Sam, my cabin mate, discovered one of the inconveniences of shipboard life.
Yeah, pretty neat setup. They got the outlets over here and the mirror over there. Yeah, so far I've been able to remember where my neck is.
As soon as you feel it too when you pull some hair out.
Yeah.
We continued south at a steady 13 knots. By the next day, the seas had calmed, and icebergs signaled our arrival in Antarctica waters. By afternoon, we were sailing along Deception Island, where we would make our first landing at Mekla, an abandoned Norwegian whaling station. On the way to the landing site, Tomas briefed us on the procedures to follow.
We have crossed the Neptune Bellows, turn around and sail into Whaler's Bay.
We'll be anchored more or less in this point where this anchor is drawn. And we'll take the Zodiacs from the ship straight up to where the two water boats are on the beach. There's a nice landing site. The good thing is that it's halfway up to Neptune's window. Neptune's window is an opening along the ridge. You can see it on the port side, on the starboard side of the vessel. It's a big opening. You can hike up to this place, Neptune's window, and you will have a beautiful sight of the Antarctic continent. Stefan will be here, just keeping an eye for you not to get too close to the ridge. It's a nice hike up, but on the other side it's very steep. So that is the fastest hike down on the other side. He will be there just keeping an eye on you and also to show you the Pintado or Cape Petrels, which nest along this cliff. Also from the landing side, you can go up to the hangar along Mekla whaling station. This is an old Norwegian whaling station. It was closed in the 60s. But if you walk up to this place or run up to this place, you will find a lot of mud and you will begin to fall into that mud, and that mud actually sucks you. So just stick up to the beach and up to where the Neptune's window is. Beware, there are quite a lot of fur seals around. Somebody was saying, how can I tell the difference between a fur seal and a regular seal? A true seal, easily. This fur seal is the one that will run close to you, will be hiking with you. The other ones, they don't pay attention at all. And they have a lot of fur also. So be aware of the fur seals. And please don't enter the buildings. They are quite old and they are falling in pieces. So please don't get into the buildings. The first Zodiac will start from here at 3:30. The last one back to the ship will be at 6:30. There is one thing related with the last Zodiac. We have to tell the captain at which hour we will be steaming out from here. So I tell him 6:30. At 6:30, he's got his engines running. If we stay for a longer period of time, the engines get overheated, and so does the captain. So please, for the last Zodiac, be at 6:30, right at the landing site. You can wear your boots, you can leave your boots and your life vest on the beach, right here close to the boats, and hike, jog, or walk around. And well, we will begin by Zodiac room number 2.
Once ashore, Cindy Stone, a school teacher from Toronto, led the Antarctica swim team into the frigid waters of Whalers Bay. Some fur seals watched the fun in rapt attention, and a chin-strap penguin ran over to see what was happening. Further down the beach, a different drama was playing itself out. A hapless runner was being stalked by an aggressive skua, who normally makes its meals from penguins. Leaving our colleague to his fate, some of us ignored the warnings of Tomas and checked out the old buildings.
We're checking out our accommodations for the night here near Whalers Bay. Bed and breakfast.
As the evening waned, it was time to load up the Zodiacs and return to our floating home.
It's a little rougher than it was coming in.
Yeah.
Since there's no docks or piers in Antarctica, Zodiacs are used to ferry people from the ship to land. When the Zodiac was secured to the gangway, we were instructed not to stand up until the surly Russian sailor motioned to you. He would then propel you to the ladder, where you were on your own to climb back up on deck.
All right, welcome aboard.
Thank you.
After sailing south through the night, we were scheduled to visit Querville Island, home to a Gen 2 penguin rookery and the site of a British biological research station. After we landed, we became part of an experiment being conducted by graduate students from Cambridge University.
Then I have to pop down into the breeding group area first, just to sort of start videotaping the behavior before you get there. Will take you up onto the ridge there, tell you a bit about the experiment, and then when I start doing this, sometimes she doesn't see, so you might have to say hi. I'm too busy talking to her. And she'll take you down there and put you in the right position. It's not wildly exciting when we get there, I'm really sorry. All you have to do is sort of stand 5 meters from the penguins for 10 minutes, but please save up your questions, ask manned questions while you're there. I'm kind of concentrating doing the videotaping, but afterwards I'll be available to answer any questions you have, tell you anything you like about penguins, seals, flying birds, the universe and everything. No, I don't know. About penguins, shall we say. And that's all. And then after the 10 minutes, I have to ask you to leave the area fairly abruptly so that I can also get their reaction once you've gone. And then that's it. Then you're free to do whatever you like. All in all, it'll take up a little over 15 minutes.
Once the experiment started, all we had to do was enjoy the Gen 2 penguins as they went about their daily routines. We also learned a great deal. One fact we learned was that penguin chicks dine on krill that is vomited up by the parent. A second fact we learned was that the parents feed only one of their two chicks. This is done to ensure that at least one survives. We discovered that the smell of a rookery comes from a natural excrement called guano, which is found and produced in abundance. It was noted that penguins are determined climbers. We even saw a penguin or two that looked like they might be training for the Antarctica Marathon. The final fact we learned was that penguins are at home in the water and never far from it. Too soon, it was time to leave our new friends and return to the ship. We reluctantly boarded the Zodiacs for the chilly ride back through the icebergs. Late that afternoon, we sailed into Paradise Bay at latitude 61 degrees, 41 minutes south. We'd land on the Antarctic continent at an unmanned Chilean research station at Waterboat Point on Paradise Bay. The local residents didn't seem to mind our wandering amidst the buildings of the research station. Of course, we were careful not to interrupt the local church service that was in progress. This fellow served as a reminder that most of us hadn't been able to run for nearly a week. While some of the locals fished for krill, others waited for the food to be delivered. Before long, we had to return to the ship. We had a race to run. Back on board, we headed for the dining room and loaded our plates for the pre-race meal. Our ship would travel through the night to reach the site of the race, the Uruguayan General Artigas Station, located on King George Island. Sunday, February 5th. It was race day on King George Island. Race director Tom Gilligan boarded our ship to brief us on the race.
Dining rooms and briefing.
I'm sure that many of you who have run standard marathons are going to be confronted by a much more challenging course. We'll start right in the Uruguayan base, head right for the water, run along the beach. It's rocky, but you're only on it for about a quarter of a mile at the most. So after the first half mile, you're going to hit the glacier. And all of you have this romantic idea about running on a glacier. There's gonna be no romance after you start running.
two-thirds of a mile up a straight up a glacier. But the climb is worth the view, because when you get to the top, you'll see the friendly Drake again. And there'll be huge icebergs just sitting there waiting to greet you. And you'll hit that about 3 miles. So you'll come off the glacier, you'll have to cross over this very shallow stream. It's a little bit muddy in part, but we have it high enough, so you'll be running on stony and gravelly area, but it's okay. It's just a little bit after 8:30, so you can go back to your cabins, get your stuff ready. There's no rush, we have plenty of time, so let's just take it easy, conserve your energy. I need six volunteers to come see me so we can get organized for that.
Anxious runners were ferried to the start in ubiquitous zodiacs.
This is going to be one wild event.
It's quite warm. Mm.
This is exciting.
40 degrees.
This is really exciting. Help, they're scaring us on that other boat.
Once on land, we milled about nervously, waiting for the start.
Power bars here. What are they going for?
The Canadian TV crew grabbed some last-minute interviews.
Just looking forward to a good day. Sun's coming out, so it might even be better than we thought.
Nerves!
Nerves?
Nerves!
Worry about everyone. I say, gee, can I do it? I've done it 415 times, but I don't know if I can do it 416 or not.
I bet you're scared shitless.
No, I went to the bathroom 3 times before I got off the ship.
The 3 Seattleites, myself, Eric Frieden, and Kevin Cahill, posed for the press back home. Soon, it was time for the start. 105 runners lined up behind the start banner. At the sound of the gun, we were off. Was very difficult. After running along a rocky beach, the route turned left to ascend the glacier. The footing was very slippery and treacherous. Once at the summit, the course took us on a wild run down the other side of the glacier. The first aid station was located about 3 miles into the race. From here, we ran along a beach, then twisted through a series of low hills. The soft and spongy ground quickly sapped the spring out of everyone's legs. The next aid station was reached by crossing a small valley and fording a stream. More hills awaited before heading back towards Maxwell Bay, where our ships lay at anchor. The third aid station was at 6 miles. Here, the challenge was to locate your own water bottle. From From this aid station, the course headed north on a road which connects the research stations that dot the island. Ahead, we could see the next checkpoints, the Chilean Frey March Station and the Russian Bellinghausen Station. Much of the road was covered by ankle-deep mud, which stuck to our shoes and added unwanted weight to already tired legs. Throngs of cheering spectators lined the route. After running down a steep hill, we encountered the most runnable section of the course. This road led to the turnaround at the China Wall Station, 9 miles into the race. The return trip took us over the same muddy roads, back to the start of the second loop, and the finish line for the half marathoners. Reaching the aid station coming back, some of us confirmed the route to Artigas. It didn't pay to go off course.
You picked up the orange flag.
So we started going for the tall vertical poles, and they were just going right up the glacier, so we went almost a quarter mile too high.
The wrong way. We were way up high, and we had to come back down, and it's a good thing the guy came from with the ATV. I went into a crevasse about up to my waist.
We fell into our crevasses up to our waist. And
it was frightening.
And we were in a whiteout as well.
Just before the finish line, we had the opportunity to run through a swiftly flowing stream for one last time. The men's winner was Harry Johnson, a mountain guide and trail runner from Alaska. The women's winner was Kathy Tibbetts, an ophthalmologist from New Mexico. For some, the course proved too difficult to master. This runner from Kent finished in 21st place and was happy with a sub-5-hour time. That night, we celebrated our victories with a dance in an energy-charged Quonset hut at the base. The day following the race was spent visiting two research stations on King George Island. The first was Brazil's Comandante Ferraz Station, where the main attraction was a whale skeleton put together by Jacques Cousteau. And the second was Poland's Henryk Arctowski Station, where the highlight was the elephant seal waller. We had been warned about the danger of fur seals, so when one decided to move, everyone got out of its way. Finally, to everyone's relief, the seal slipped into the water and swam away. nearly everyone was relieved.
Here are three of the oldest men in the race. Perhaps in the world.
That's to say it. It's capture it on film.
Don is going about the same pace that he moved yesterday.
Tired and broke, it was time to leave Antarctica and head home.
I visualize really rough weather, right? We've been lucky, I think.
The rough ride in the Zodiac back to the ship was only a hint of what we were in store for tomorrow. The next morning, we were back in the Drake Passage and in the middle of a Force 7 storm. It was more fun than riding a roller coaster.
Oh, the waves crash in and the tide pulls out. It's an angry sea, but there is no doubt that the lighthouse will keep shining out to warn the lonely sailor. The lightning strikes and the wind cuts cold through the sailor's bones to the sailor's soul, till there's nothing left that he can hold except the rolling ocean. But I am ready for the storm. Yes, sir, ready. I am ready for the storm. I'm ready for the storm. My dreams, 'cause every confrontation seems to tell me what it really means to be this lonely sailor. And when you take me by your side, you love me warm, you love me, and I should have realized I had no reasons to be frightened. But I am ready for storm. Yes, sir, ready. I am ready for the storm. I'm ready for the storm.
The following day brought calmer seas and smooth sailing. However, passengers had to endure another threat to their health, cabin fever.
Well, we're coming to you from Antarctica, the Antarctic Ocean. It's behind us out the window here. It's probably hard to see. This is my friend Dan, the penguin. He's an emperor penguin. Very proud. He doesn't have an egg. He lost it, so he's been banished from his tribe. And because of that, I'm bringing him back to Seattle to live. So we'll be back in a couple of days. We're still about 30 hours or so from landing in Ushuaia. So Dan and I are finishing up the rest of the voyage by eating as much as we can, right? He misses his other people, but he's real happy to be coming to Seattle, and we'll be seeing you real soon. So he'll be living with Tesha, he thinks, in her room. And you try not to poop all over the floor like they do on the rocks, right? Okay, see you then.
At long last, we reached Cape Horn, the southernmost point in South America, and the start of our journey back to Ushuaia. We reached Ushuaia the following morning, and from there began our flights back to our homes throughout the world. We would all take with us cherished memories of the Antarctica Marathon, but especially of Antarctica.